Are you ready for the timer? All right, 3, 2, 1, go. All right, guys, finally. There's a little technical difficulty there, but we got it going. So this is a Majora's Mask Any% speedrun. For a lot of people that have never seen this kind of a speedrun before in the 3D Zelda series, even if you've never played this game, it's ridiculously awesome to watch because there is so many cool tricks that just aesthetically look cool. So I'm going to kind of break it down basically as to how it's going to progress, because it starts off slow, builds up fast, and then just kind of progresses into nonstop action towards the end. The average length for a solid run is about 1 hour 35 to 1 hour 40 minutes for like a decent run. The world record right now is 1 hour 25 minutes and 41 seconds by Fenir. My personal best is 1 hour 26 minutes and 39 seconds. So if I could beat the game in under 1 hour 30 during this run, that would be awesome. I don't think I'm able to do that, because one of the things that's kind of tricky right now is because the TV is not the one I'm used to playing on. Every CRT TV feels a little bit different, so because of that, I might make some mistakes because it just doesn't feel properly. But essentially what's going to be happening here is I'm going to end up using several of the glitches and exploits found in this game to sequence break it and kind of beat it in an out of order situation, so that by the time I get to the end of it, I have all the necessary requirements in the fastest possible time to get to the Majora battle, which is how you beat the game. So a little bit about this particular speedrun. This is the Japanese version of the game. You'll notice when the text starts appearing, it's going to be in Japanese characters. That's because it's faster than English text, because there's less characters per text box in Japanese. And on top of that, the Japanese version actually came out 6 months before the US version. So because of that, there's a bunch of specific glitches that are actually in the JP version that are not in the US one. So if you want, you could consider the JP version as almost a beta. And because of that, a lot of the stuff got patched out in the English one. So some of the glitches in this one actually speed it up by a couple minutes, to be precise. And I'll be explaining those more as we get towards the sections and stuff. But, okay, so here's what's going to happen relatively more towards the beginning. The first 20 minutes is the most boring thing ever. Like, there's nothing. Like, it's literally just text and cutscenes, and then more text and more cutscenes, and then all the action starts around the 20-minute mark. So you're going to notice there's like a tipping point in this part of the run where after all of this is over, it's just like a 3-2-1 go, and then it picks up, and then everything just starts to kind of fall into place, and all the cool glitches start to happen. And basically, the reason for that is because there's cycles. What I mean by a cycle is, if you've never played this game, the way to save in this game is you play the Song of Time, and you go back to the beginning of the first day. There's a 3-day cycle where it's broken down into 72 hours, and each day basically brings the moon closer to the Earth, and on the third day it crashes into Termina, which is the area, and if that happens, it's game over, and you basically reset to the last time you played the Song of Time. So what's happening is a cycle is considered every time you play the Song of Time and restart from day one. So you beat this game in an Any% speedrun, which is the fastest way possible, in 5 cycles. And the first cycle is the one I'm saying is the boring one, because there is nothing you can do except one objective, and that's get the ocarina. So I'll talk about that in just a sec. Let me get past these logs, which I hate. These are like my sworn enemy. I hate them. Okay, I actually got them. Sometimes I fall off the logs, and the first movement in the game is actually a mistake. But I got through them, so that's cool. Anyways, the first cycle, there's one objective, and that's getting the ocarina. And in order to do that, we have to do this whole objective in Clock Town, which is the area we're going to be in just after this part. And in Clock Town, you do it as a Deku Scrub, which you'll see we get turned into very soon. And basically what happens is you enter the Clock Tower, you grab the ocarina, and then the first thing you do is you play Song of Time and reset the cycle. And then the point of that is to go back and turn into a human so that you can do more, because you're very limited in what you're able to accomplish as a Deku Scrub. So you'll notice that it's just really cutscene heavy and there's nothing really happening. But right now, it's just really, there isn't much to explain. Some of the stuff I'm going to be showing, actually, I should actually mention that I'm going to do a pretty YOLO route. So I thought, you know what, I haven't gotten to showcase some of the really cool stuff that's hard to do in this game, because it's not marathon friendly, so to say, because if you miss it, you lose several minutes. But okay, I told the guy that I was going to do an estimate of 1 hour 45, even though I don't need that much time to beat the game, because if I want to factor in just in case I screw up the really tough things. But I want to show you guys, because it's like, it's so cool. So you'll end up seeing that there is basically these like two particular sections, I'll name them when we get to them, that involve a trick called mega flipping. which is a very precise bomb technique that lets me get really far distance off a bomb explosion, and I'm able to do some pretty funky teleporting with it. And it's really precise, but really hard, and I'm gonna do it anyways, because, like, who cares? And if I miss it, I miss it, whatever. We're still gonna make the estimate, so it's all good. And yeah, I just wanted to prepare you guys, because, like, it's pretty hard, so I'll let you know when it happens. But for now, we're just gonna finish the cutscenes. I'm trying to, like, talk over the cutscenes, because the more I say, like, it's just, it passes the time a little more. The first skip we're gonna get to is something called the Happy Master Salesman cutscene skip, and it's pretty cool. I guess I could use this time to kind of explain as to what it is. Basically, in this game, cutscenes for some reason take 2 frames to activate, which I find really strange, but it's something the developers did. And because of that, we can kind of exploit that mechanic in certain circumstances. So, like, you're able to pause 1 frame at a time in a loading area that would trigger a cutscene. And because you're never giving the game 2 frames to activate the cutscene, you can move through it buffering 1 frame at a time with the pausing and unpausing of the menu. So we're actually going to skip that cutscene, or hopefully, if I miss it, I miss it. It's not a big deal. We get to watch a 40-second cutscene. Yay. But if not, we get to skip the cutscene and enter Clock Town that much faster. So the better you do the buffers, the more time you save. Optimally, it would be like a 45-second time save, so it's pretty significant. All right. But yeah, I really hope you guys enjoy this. It's always a pleasure showcasing these runs, because I like showing the potential of this game to people, especially if they're familiar with the game. My favorite is people that have seen the game and played it as a kid or whatever, and then especially MM3D, now people are more familiar with it, but seeing what is possible in the original. So here's a potential text skip. Normally that flower coming up has a second of text. If I do a side hop properly, I can skip it. Okay, got it. So it's a little trickier than it looks, but whatever, who cares about that text box? Okay, so here's where we do the pause buffering. I need to focus here, because it's pretty precise. Okay, that was a really nice one too, actually. Sick. So you can see, like, I missed like 2 or 3, that sucks. But I actually had some pretty clean ones there, which was nice. And optimally, okay, so, like, I know this game so well when it comes to the speedrun that I know that a good time to get out of into Clock Town is around 7 minutes, 40 seconds is, like, really good. That was probably under 7 minutes, 50 seconds, so I'm really happy with that, especially for a run that I'm showcasing you guys what's up. Alright, so normally when you enter a Clock Town, Cycle 1 is usually chock full of really stupid objectives that you have to complete. And normally what you have to do is, you have to do like this whole Bomber's Quest, where you have to get like code, then you collect a Moon's Tear, then you have to give this Moon's Tear to some Deku Scrub. He lets you like hop onto this platform, and then you can enter the Clock Tower on the third day when it's nighttime at midnight. And that's the only time the door opens, on the last day. But there's a couple ways to skip all that stuff to speed things up, so we're gonna do that. And very conveniently, in this hotel, we have Grandma, and she tells really boring stories. So what we can do is talk to Grandma, and if you ask her to tell the second story, so this one over here, you fall asleep and it becomes the next day. So now it's the second day. So you can look at the bottom on the in-game clock, it says second. Then I do it again, she tells the same story again, and now it's the last day. So I fast-forwarded 2 days. Also, really cool note, it says last, and that the Japanese version actually says last, and the English version says final. I have no idea why they switched that, but it's a cool little difference between the two. Alright, so it's still daytime, we still need to make it nighttime, and I'm not prepared to wait 12 in-game hours, which would translate to about 6 minutes in real time. So we're gonna speed things up a little bit. So on this side of the Clock Town, there is Scarecrow. And the Scarecrow is, like, he just, like, you talk to him, he does some, like, weird stuff, and then it's nighttime. It's like, I don't even know what it is. It's like some cool dance. So yeah, he goes nuts. He's a party. Okay. So now it's nighttime. So good. So now we only have to wait a few minutes instead of an entire day or half a day. And we have till 12 o'clock in-game time. So anything I do right now will not waste any time because I have to wait till the door opens at midnight. So you can see the sun spinning around the in-game clock. Every time it gets to the top, that's 1 hour past. So right now you can see on the left side it's 6 o'clock. So I have 6 in-game hours. So I can make good use of that time actually and collect rupees. I'll show you how we're going to do that. First thing we're going to do is we're going to go here. And we're going to go pick up a fairy. Because if we return the stray fairy to the fairy fountain, the great fairy gets restored and she gives us a magic bar, which will come in really handy. And then this guard literally sucks. He can't do anything. You could just sneak past him. So now we're in Termina. We're not supposed to be in Termina, but we are. And it's pretty cool. You'll notice it's pretty deserted. There's nothing. And that's because if you enter Termina before 12 o'clock, none of the enemies in any like load. It's just a barren wasteland, basically. And it's pretty interesting that the actors, aka the enemies in this game from Termina, happen to load after you trigger that 12 o'clock cutscene. So because of that, we're able to freely roam, and the grass patches are still there, and we're able to collect rupees. The reason I'm collecting rupees is because I'm going to use them to purchase explosives. And normally what happens when you play Song of Time, you end up losing all your money and stuff because you go back in time and you go to a point in time when you never had these rupees in the first place. But for some reason they made a bank that keeps your rupees when you go back in time because they had to come up with some stupid excuse to like keep your rupees. So we're going to collect a ton of rupees and then we're going to go and deposit them at the bank. And then next cycle I'm going to use those rupees to purchase explosives. Ideally I want a minimum of 60 because that's like the amount that I would need to purchase the right number of explosives in the next cycle. But a good number, an optimal number is 90, which you just see I got. So that's really awesome. It doesn't really save that much time. The reason that's cool is because when you talk to the banker, he asks you how much you want to deposit. And to scroll to a 9 from 0 is just a flick down versus a 6, which would be 4 flicks down. So the more you collect towards a 0 is better when it comes to the trying to save time. So it honestly saves like 2 seconds. It's not a big deal, but because it's a speed run, we get happy about those little time saves. All right, sweet. So now we do some funky movement up here, and we can get to the fairy fountain. Cool. All right, so far so good. I told you, the beginning is kind of boring. It's just like a little bit of movement like here and there, and it's like, okay, I gotta do this, gotta do that, whatever. But yeah, I can't wait to try the hard stuff. It's gonna go so ridiculously bad. Hopefully it doesn't. Knock on couch. All right, so now we have a handy magic bar. We need that magic bar for a couple reasons. One, it makes things a little faster later. And most importantly, we can shoot the Deku bubbles. They're like snob bubbles. It's weird. But you can use them to hit the Skull Kid when he's holding your ocarina and he drops it, and that's how you get it. It's the only way to get him to drop the ocarina, as we know right now in the first cycle. It's just not possible to get it any other way. So we're kind of forced into it. There's like some really cool glitches, actually, that allow you to shoot magic without a magic bar. Like, use the magic bar effects. It's so cool, but It's not practical for this run, so we're not going to see that. All right, so now I'm just going to the bank, and then I'm going to go to the clock tower. And now, normally, people go, okay, well, that's awesome, but you didn't complete the quest that you were supposed to in the first cycle. How are you going to get on top of that platform for the clock tower? Good question. And basically, it's just a gainer. Like, if you're familiar, a gainer is a forward backflip. It's like a gymnastic trick, I'm pretty sure. But in this game, it's actually useful. You can do a backflip with forward momentum, and you can grab a ledge you're not supposed to normally reach because the height of the backflip gives you that much reach to like reach it. So check this out. So we have a little bit of time to kill still. I actually completed all that pretty quickly. It's 11:30 in game time. And then you do that backflip and skips the entire thing. So normally you have to like get in that flower and then fly up here. And I'm not gonna get that heart piece because it's pointless, absolutely pointless. So boom, now it's midnight, we're good. So this is the cutscene that if we would go to Termina now, after watching this, there would be like all the enemies. You would see everything. Okay, so we're just gonna grab the ocarina now, some more text, and then we'll be good to go. And you'll notice I'll do something kind of funny after I learn Song of Time and everything. I'll explain it when I get there. So yeah, we use our snot bubble, and then he drops ocarina. And boom, we're in business now. Okay, so more cutscenes. There's about 4 minutes more of cutscenes, and then we can start the fast-paced portion of this run. Now, there's going to be a couple of really interesting things about the second part of this run, which is the second cycle. And like I said, it's broken down into 5 cycles. The second cycle is... Okay, let me backtrack, actually. Here's basically the outrun, like, of how this works, or the breakdown. The first 45 minutes, if you want to break it into an hour and a half of a run, the first 45 minutes is setting up to do all the temples. There's 4 temples. And then the last 45 minutes is doing the temples with the stuff we did in the first 45 minutes. You basically, like, use all the stuff you collected and stuff. So... Hang on, Song of Time really quickly. Okay. And then, so essentially what's going to happen is, the backbone to this whole speedrun is bombs. Like, explosives, explosives, explosives. Like, we just use a ton of bombs and bomb chews. And we're able to do a ton of different techniques. And to name a few, there's like the super slide, which you'll see is a really fast form of traveling other than Goron rolling or any type of like backwalking. It's way faster than backwalking or rolling or anything like that. So... You're going to see a ton of super slides. You're going to see something called a hyper-extended super slide, which is a trick that allows me to get the same speed as a super slide, but turn and stuff, because you can actually use it to turn. Then you're going to see me do a bunch of tricks called bomb boosting, which like uses a bomb to like get to something I'm not supposed to reach. And just a bunch of other stuff. And I'll point it out to you, like the most significant one being bomb hovering, which you'll find really obvious. Alright, so you'll see I just reset there, which looks awful, because it looks like I just kind of like killed everything. But actually, it's really funny. Normally, when you hit yes for the first time to save there, that's what I just did. Like, it said, do you want to save, yes or no? And I hit yes, there's a cutscene that starts, and it like basically goes, you go back in time, and it like repeats everything that went down in the last like cycle that you just did. But it's slow, and it happens to go faster if you just reset, because as soon as you hit the yes, the game saves. So you don't have to wait or anything, like it's just like, yes, reset, and then you can watch this, and then now we're back here, and you can see that on my C button on the top right, I have an ocarina, which means everything went according to plan. So now we talk to this guy, and then he says, well, whatever, chokes me to death, and then gives me a song. But yeah, bomb hovering is like probably the coolest looking trick if you've never seen a speedrun of a 3D Zelda before. They're very abundant. Like you see them in Ocarina of Time as well. So if you like Majora's Mask and you've never seen 3D Zelda speedruns, then definitely check out Ocarina of Time speedruns as well, because they're the same kind. You're actually going to be seeing a bunch of Ocarina of Time stuff as soon as this run is finished. It's like a whole Zelda block. So we're going to have like 3-4 hours of Zelda. Definitely recommend checking it all out. And it's actually Mr. Gregor Tixelkins over here, Mr. Maltov, are the Ocarina of Time guys. They're going to take over as soon as I finish here. And Mr. Fuzziness in the corner, he's also going to do some Ocarina of Time. So I'll be sticking around on couch hopefully for that, if they give me the privilege. It'd be cool. But I don't know that much about it, so I'm not going to be doing too much commentary on it. All right, so now we're a human, and there's one more big cutscene, and then just a little more text, and we're good. But now you know why I said at the beginning's boring, because it's pretty hefty when it comes to the cutscene text. It's heavy, man. There's a lot of stuff. And the worst part is no one cares. Nobody cares about this at all. I just want to go fast, man. Like, please let me go fast. I just want to go fast. People were making the bad joke that I was like practicing Young Link for Smash. And I was just like nodding my head. I was like, oh my god. I've always been a Smash 64 guy. Like, being at this event, there's so much melee, but like, I'm a diehard Smash 64 guy. I grew up with that stuff, man. It's so good. I'm OG with it. That game doesn't get enough love, honestly. Like, it just... I wish Smash 64 got more love. Alright, back to business. We're good now. All the cutscenes are over.
Serious time.
It's serious time now. And this is like where one of the more difficult tricks is going to start to happen, so hopefully it goes according to plan. Alright, so now as a human, we have a lot more we can do. So this is the last text, and now comes the stuff. So the first thing we're going to do is, remember we put money in the bank? We're going to get a little more money than that, so we can use two sets of 99 rupees. The first is in this chest on East Clock Town, so I'm going to make hook a left and go in here. And now it's all movement, so you'll see, like, there's very little downtime. So I'm going to work my way around, trying to, like, optimize my rolls as much as possible. Cross over. I can do, like, some fancy jumps over here. And then just parkour my way around. Awesome. Then we go to West Clock Town, and we're going to buy our first set of explosives. A lot of people don't know this, but in this game, there's no, like, you can just go and buy explosives. Like, there's no, like, requirement before you can get them, like, in Ocarina of Time. You can just go to the bomb shop if you have the money and buy explosives. Even in Cycle 1, the only problem is you can't use them as a Deku. So I talked to this guy from as far away as possible, because that's less movement back to leaving the bomb shop. So I'm going to buy a bomb bag. And I'm going to buy bomb shoes. Awesome. Alright, so now I'm going to leave and equip my two explosives. And we're going to do trick number one. I'll explain it after I finish it. Okay. So that's a glitch called Infinite Sword Glitch. You can see my sword's infinitely swinging. This is a bomb hover. That's an Ocarina dive. So the bomb hovering is triggered based on Infinite Sword Glitch. Infinite Sword Glitch lets you stand on bomb explosives, or explosions, I should say. And that's because when you're swinging your sword in this game, you can't fall off an edge. So because of that property, the game treats the explosion as ground, and I'm able to stand on the explosions. Now, I hit that owl, which is an owl you're not supposed to hit. In this game, the owls are actually how you transport to different regions efficiently, because it's a pretty vast world. So in order to do it quickly, you could just get the song that lets you teleport to those owl statues, which we'll be getting. But the requirement usually means that you have to hit the owl statue before you can use it. But that owl statue is actually a glitched owl statue and allows me to travel to any owl in the game without ever visiting it in the first place. So I can sequence break everything. I can go to like the last level without having to ever visit it in the first place. Now comes the hardest trick in the game. Also, that Ocarina dive allowed me to store the effect of Song of Double Time to make it night without watching a cutscene. So here's a super slide. This is the hardest part in the run, by the way. This is like the part that I like gave the game limit another 15 minutes for the estimate. Another super slide. And we're going to go in here. And here we go. Beautiful. That was beast. That was really
nice
good.
Job.
Okay.
Nice.
Then we're gonna do some fancy bomb hovers on this thing. We're gonna clip up here. And then we're gonna go up here and we're in business. Nice. Okay. So that was the hardest part in the run and we're good now. I have no stress now. I feel so good. So I'm gonna explain what the heck just went down, cause like, it's weird. So I went in one grotto and came out another grotto and ended up in Deku Palace and went and got the Sonata with some really weird clipping. And basically the reason that works is because the grottos are all on the same map. The only thing is you only see the graphics of the one you enter. So because of that, you think it's just that one grotto. But if you exit out of bounds in that grotto, you can enter one of the other ones on the map that, and it's unloaded. So there's no graphics, there's no actors. The only thing that there is hit detection and the entrances, which is like the light that you can see from the outside. So if you touch the entrance zone in an unloaded grotto, you exit where it is in the game. So I actually, like, that was the grotto I was in. It was just unloaded and then exit into Deku Palace, which is the fastest way here. So then what I did was I used some fancy bomb hovering to clip onto the platform because I know like there's weird hit detection on those platforms. And I was able to get to the Sonata room really quickly to pick it up. I need this song because I'm going to get into Woodfall Temple with it. It lets me raise the temple up. So I cannot beat the game unless I get this song, which is why I came here in the first place. And it's convenient because in the route, I actually pick up Song of Soaring, which is just outside Deku Palace and stuff. And you'll see that. It's just like a bunch of other things. There is one more crucial thing. Like, I nailed those two mega flips, by the way. If you noticed, I did those two really big backflips. That's a mega flip. And people always say, like, hey, Phil, like, what's a mega flip? And I'm like, it's a backflip, but that's mega. Like, it's what it is. It's just a huge backflip. So it's pretty easy to spot it when you see it. And basically, it saves explosives. The reason that's really cool is because I still have 10 bomb chews at my disposal, which I can use later to complete a more difficult portion of the run. Now I can jump up here. So that's a nice little shortcut. And then grab this. Ask the guy if the timer's running. I hope it's running.
27:42.
Okay. Yeah, that makes sense. Yeah, because I can get like a sub-27 Sonata with a really, really, really good run.
Awesome.
So that's good.
You were like 75% on that.
Dude, before I went live with you guys, I was practicing it on this TV because I was scared of the TV. And I missed it like 5 times, and I was like shaking. I was like, no, I don't want to mess this up because it's so cool. And then I hit it, so I'm really glad it worked out. That's the one thing about marathon runs. Every CRT you do a marathon run on is different, so you never know what you're gonna get. You always have to like hope for the best. All right, so this is a cool trick. This is called reverse Octorok skip. Use the bomb. Recoil past the Octorok. Oh, these lily pads suck. They're always in different position. They're actually random number generator, which is basically RNG for short. And RNG is what's luck based in this game. So those lily pad positions are random every run. So sometimes you get like a good hop and you land on it. Sometimes you get a bad hop and you end up like hopping randomly. Okay, cool. So we got a stick. I need a Deku stick and a Deku nut. I'm gonna end up transforming them into bottles. You'll see. It's pretty cool. All right, so then I can super slide into the woods. And now we're gonna do a hyper extended super slide. I get one shot at this, so I hope I get it. All right, nice. Insane. So that's what I was saying before. Hyperextended Super Slide is like the fancy Super Slide. You can go as fast as you're going when you're doing a regular one, except you can turn. So now we're gonna go here, grab a red potion. And instead of healing the witch, she says, bring me a red potion, but like we're just gonna steal it and do other things. Perfect. So now, play Song of Soaring. And we're gonna head out to Mountain Village, which you'll notice we have never been to before. But with the use of that special owl, we can hit Mountain Village early. All right, so we're gonna pick up a bomb drop. Super slide across, because it's fast. And then we're gonna do some fancy movement this way. Can recoil off that guy, so it looks cool. Then another super slide up the bridge, because we wanna go fast. And then we're gonna leave. And it's like, well, why did we just do that if we're leaving? That's weird. And that's because the way it works is to travel to a certain destination, you have to have visited a prerequisite destination for that trick to work. So each location corresponds to a place you're gonna travel to. The default one is Great Bay. So if you just play Song of Soaring like you just saw, I end up going to Great Bay. And what happens is, you don't have to put the position on anything. But if I, on the pause menu, when you, how to explain this? Basically, when you put the cursor on the pause menu on a destination, that correlates to where you're gonna travel. So Goron Village, where I just visited, is now available on my pause menu. If I put the cursor on it, on the map, it takes me to Stone Tower Temple. So that's how I'm gonna skip the Stone Tower section of the game. Okay, now here comes a cool trick. There's a whole bunch of stuff that goes down here. Pay attention to the C stick, the C buttons, I should say. You'll notice I broke the stick and used my Deku Nut. Drink my potion, pick up this rock and pick up some bugs, I'm sorry. Oh, I missed, okay, it's not a problem. I can just pick up the bugs again and try again. So what's gonna happen is, I'm gonna transform the stick into nuts. So now look at the sticks on C left, they're now a bottle. And now look at the nuts, they're a bottle. So that's not a big deal, that was like a 10 second error, it's not a problem. All right, so now that I have three bottles, I need a fourth one, which I'll get later. Go behind this guy. Do a glitch called Time Stop, which is the end, it's basically the, like, it's the state of when you're trying to empty a bottle, but you are able to move in that state. So because of that, we're able to move during any cutscene. It basically takes over any cutscene that would stop you from being able to move and allow you access to Link. So I was able to do everything that I was supposed to do in that time stop state and raise the Zora. Like the Zora, normally he like gets to the beach and he walks up to the beach and then he falls, and it takes a long time because he walks really slowly. But by doing time stop, he was able to walk up the beach and I was able to leave the area, which is really cool. And because of that, I don't have to watch him walk up the beach, which is slow. And then I just come back and play Song of Healing. I actually had really good bomb count there because I didn't mess up. So I was able to use an extra bomb to super slide to him, which is really cool. Saving all the frames. And now this is like that really famous one. Like everyone gets sad when this guy dies. I just want him to die so I can grab his Zora mask. Just like, hurry up. It's not, who cares? Fuzziness loves the Zora, I don't know. Enop has a Zora Bible thump. The Nop thump? Oh, yeah. The the Swedish movie one, Hanelun. Hanelun. Yeah. Shout out to Fenir. Fenir is the guy with the world record. He always plays this really epic cutscene in a movie. And it's like, it's become like literally famous. It's so good. No, it's funny. Alright, so we got a handy Zora mask now, and this guy can finally go away. So now we're going to do a couple things. I got a bunch of bottles. There's a reason for that. I have to collect Zora eggs, and that's to learn Nueve Bossa Nova. I need that song because it takes me to Great Bay Temple. Otherwise, I can't get into the temple. So, the seven Zora eggs are scattered between Pirate's Fortress and Pinnacle Rock. There's four in the fortress and three in the Pinnacle Rock area. Now, what I'm going to do is, because I have extra bottles, I'm able to... Oops, I don't know why I transformed there. That was weird. I normally don't. It's not a big deal. Okay. So I can work my way... Oops. Normally I don't touch the water there. Work my way around here. It's not the big, not the end of the world. And we're going to do Pirate's Fortress first. So, cool thing about Pirate's Fortress. Remember I said the JP version, the Japanese version, has like a bunch of exclusive things that aren't in the English? Here's one of those main differences. And that's that the pirates in the Japanese version have really poor vision. They don't see very well, and you can sneak by them. And we're going to take advantage of that and exploit a couple mechanics. The second thing is that we normally, when you do the Pirate's Fortress in a casual playthrough, you have to do a pirate fight for each egg. There's a pirate guarding each one. And it's annoying because you kind of just want to get the egg and move on to the next thing. So there's entrances for each section, and then there's exits. And with some funky movement, we can get into the exits and collect the egg and go in from the back for those sections. So we can avoid each pirate fight, except for one. We fight one pirate, but we do it fairly quickly, you'll see. And we can actually take advantage of it by emptying our bottle bug during a cutscene so that we can make room for an egg in that one. Now, normally you have to go in the sewers in the Pirate's Fortress, but if you remember bomb hovering, I can take advantage of them and just cross the gap. So it looks kind of cool because I'm like floating in midair with these hovers. So five hovers gets me across. If I want to be a tryhard, I could do a mega flip here, but I'm like, you know how I feel about that, so we're not going to do that. So we're just going to do one extra hover. It would be four explosives over five. Perfect. So now we're in the main fortress. The next trick is really cool. It's called the Pirate's Fortress Long Jump, which is where we're going to abuse the pirate's vision. And we're going to just like literally side hop in front of a pirate and she's not going to see. And then what we're going to do is we're going to use our bomb to avoid being seen by the pirates and climb onto the tank so we can get the hook shot. So we go here. This pirate doesn't see anything. That's what I was talking about. Go here. We clip a bomb up onto this barrel. And we cannot be seen because we're just really fast. And then we can take out the beehive from here. So perfect. So now the pirates freak out and they leave, and we can grab the hookshot. And our first egg. I think my favorite part of that trick, like a lot of people love the jump because it's like, how do they not see the jump and explosion? Like, wow, video game, please. But my favorite thing is the bomb clipping onto the barrel. It's like the most simple thing, but it's so cool. It's like, why does that even happen? Okay. But yeah, now you know what I mean by it picking up. Like it gets really fast paced after. All right, so now that we have the hookshot, we keep going. We're going to collect the last remaining three eggs in here. And like I said, instead of fighting pirates because it's slow, we're going to go around the exits. So the first egg is to the left. Quick hookshot and another bottle. We can use the hookshot to clip, shoot up this. We can recoil into the exit. So that's the first exit. And we're going to grab egg number two. And let's get out of here. So the pirate fight was actually to the left. If you saw, there was that other door. That's where we would have come from if we did it properly. Then we go here. And now I'm going to turn my bombs into a bottle because I only have three out of four bottles. So I need to make another one for that fourth egg. So we're gonna do that now. The reason I didn't do it before is because I needed the bomb to clip up. I could do a jump around here, which is really weird. Also, I need to have zero bombs in this particular instance in order to make a bottle, otherwise it wouldn't work. So now I go, grab the bugs, and now they're a bottle. So, and the way it's actually really cool because if you, once you pick up an item that would be turned into a bottle otherwise, it actually turns back into that item. So I could just get bombs again and I'll have bombs back in my inventory and that bottle will disappear. So it's kind of convenient that I don't need bombs for this point of the run. Now we grab the egg, so now we have 3 out of 4 in this section. Okay, so now this is another example of the pirates having very bad vision. Sneak right by. Okay, now I can use this cutscene to empty my bottle. So that was a bad fight. She was not cooperating. Stupid pirate. Okay. So now we go out here and we can get our last egg. Now we're gonna do a glitch called Underwater Ocarina, and or in this as a Zora it's a guitar, but same thing. We sink. Oh. I normally don't kill them because it's slow, but they were being annoying. So that makes an ocarina come out. The same glitch that duplicates bottles actually creates an ocarina if you use your sword for the technique. And it's kind of a tricky, I don't need to explain like how to do it, but like, I don't know why it happens, but it creates an ocarina and we're able to just leave. So it's actually useful in Pinnacle Rock because Pinnacle Rock is interesting. I'll explain why in just a little bit. All right, so climb up here. And we'll deposit first 4 eggs. Awesome. So remember I said the first 45 minutes is just basically setting up to do the temples. After we finish Pinnacle Rock and get the last 3 eggs for the Nui Bossa Nova, we're ready to do the temples. We can just do all 4 temples, one after the other. And the only big issue is the Woodfall Bosky skip. The Woodfall Temple has a Bosky skip that's just as hard as the grotto that I did at the beginning that I was like really worried about. So that's a reset point right there. If I miss it, I'm gonna have to lose like 3-4 minutes. But again, we factored that into the estimate. So we're good. So when we go out here with some fancy movement, we can get back out. All right, so let's go to Pinnacle Rock. Normally Pinnacle Rock, if you're familiar with Ocarina of Time, there's a set path you have to take in the water, otherwise you void out and start again. If you don't know the path, there's a seahorse that you can get and it'll tell you where to go. But if you know the path, you can just use like your knowledge of where it is to like keep it going. And dolphin diving is the fastest version of movement as Zora, other than like this trick called the super swim, which I'm not gonna go for, because it's really hard. But you can Zora dive at the top if you know the path, and you just follow some visual cues on the water. And you can just kind of follow the path. Then at here, you like get to the sign and you just follow the signs and you can enter the area. So that's nice and handy. Okay, so I don't need to find where the 3 eggs are. I know where they are. First one's this one, and then the second one's at the very top, and then the last one's at the very bottom, which is important because remember I said like that ocarina glitch is really good underwater? And that's because in the old route, before that trick was found, we had to go to the bottom and then swim all the way back up. And that's really slow because this place is super deep. So, because you can play the underwater ocarina, you can just clear the top part and then go to the bottom part and leave from the bottom part, which is just super handy. So you'll see me do it at the bottom. And these eels, I don't know what they were thinking when they made these eels. It's insane. All right, grab one more of these. Yeah, these eels, I don't even understand. I don't know. It's just like, it didn't work, man. It just didn't work. All right, one, two. Perfect. So that's our third egg, and then we just leave from here. We'll see. Unless I miss, which would suck. Perfect. This ladder is made of grease. Like, they put grease on this ladder, so it's unclimbable. I hate it.
The ladder's this big.
I swear, they bought WD-40, and they put it all over the ladder. That's the hardest thing in this game, is that ladder. Okay, so I'm going to try and skip a cutscene after this. And when you learn the song, you pull the ocarina out, and remember, cutscenes take 2 frames to activate. And in this game, you can learn the song on the frame you pull the ocarina out. So if I pause on that frame, I can leave and learn the song without watching the learning process, which is like that whole cutscene. So hopefully I get it. I should be good. If I don't, whatever, it's like 25 seconds, not the end of the world. Alright, so here's where I'm gonna skip it. Nice. So I paused, and then I just leave, and I learned the song even though it looks like nothing happened. So that's really cool. Perfect. So far, so good. Next, we're gonna tackle the temples. And the temples are probably the coolest because they each have a very unique way of being done. Before we do that, though, we're gonna do something called the turtle cutscene skip, which is very infamous for being a run killer. If you miss it, you lose a minute. Here's a cool trick. This is how you moonwalk out of the water. Oh, I missed it. You can moonwalk all the way in here, but at least you got to see it a little bit. And yeah, the turtle cutscene skip's a 1-frame pause to skip the cutscene of the turtle coming out of the water when you play the song. And if you get it, you save a whole minute. If you don't get it, you lose a whole minute. So whatever, if I miss it, I miss it. If I don't, I don't. I'm pretty good at getting it. I don't want to jinx myself, but I just did. And we'll just see what happens. And then there's a follow-up trick that hopefully I can get. So I timed this. Let's see if I can get it. Okay. Okay, nice. That was a 1-minute time save. Okay. So I timed that. I pressed pause once and I get it. It's like a really difficult trick that I practiced for a long time. But I actually missed like the optimal cutscene skip technique. And so I worked with what happened, which was like an extra frame passed. All right, so here comes the follow-up. This one's really hard and really weird looking. I'll explain it. Okay, nice. Holy crap. Wow. I can't believe this is happening.
So lucky.
Nice. Double cutscene skip. Okay, awesome. So, that's ridiculous. I can't believe that just happened. Because that one's also luck based. I can only do that trick if the fairy doesn't heal me because I need to catch it in a bottle. So what just happened there was, normally there's a cutscene that takes you to the temple. I just skipped it by doing a time stop technique again, like last time. And instead of doing like the Zora walking, it was the turtle leaving. And I was able to cancel the trip by entering Zora Hall again. and then it just gave me the effect of me already being here before. So you can skip this whole dungeon in 20 seconds. You can complete the entire thing by going under the stairs here and just do a bomb explosion recoil flip, and I'm in the boss. That's it. All right, perfect. Let's kick this guy's butt. So it's pretty cool. So this is a pretty solid segment, man. I hit every trick in this segment. That's awesome. That never goes well. Even when I'm like on my own stream, it's an absolute destruction. I think the timer may be off a little bit. I can't believe that's sub 50. There's no way that's sub 50. That's really fast. I'll gauge it, but we'll see. I like to break that pot. Oh, I didn't break that pot. That's fine, whatever. Okay, so fortunately, the hookshot actually damages this guy, which allows us to not have the bow for this fight. Now, I can combo this guy in the water. Then he makes his babies, no one cares, and then we kill him after. Alright, nice. Alright, he dies. Nice. Good fight. A lot of people hate this boss. I personally don't care about this boss because he just dies really quickly. Alright, so I'm gonna grab a heart container here. And it makes my life a lot easier because the bosses at the end of the game deal a full heart of damage. So having a fourth hit, just in case of emergency, never hurts for 2 second time loss. All the runners grab this heart container because it's just... I've had it where you have a run without it and you lose because you didn't have the fourth hit. And I swore that day, I was like, never again. I will never skip that heart container as long as I live. So we have to watch this cutscene. It's imperative we watch this cutscene because we need to learn the Oath to Order, which is only possible from the first boss that you kill. And we need that song to summon the four giants, which allows us to get to the moon and fight Majora. But if you never watch any of these cutscenes, you don't learn the song and the game is unbeatable. So there is a way to skip these cutscenes, but as long as you watch one, you're good. If you skip all four using that method, you can't do anything. So getting the first one is imperative, and then the next three, we skip them. It's also really cool because this one just, coincidentally happens to be the fastest, because normally when you clear one of the four regions, there's an effect from beating the boss that happens to the area. So in the snow area, it'll all melt, all the snow will melt, or in the swamp area, all the poison water will turn to fresh water. And in this area, it's just the guy says some stuff to you, the turtle says stuff to you, and that's it. And then you can just keep playing. So we use that to our advantage as well, so we don't have to wait for anything to happen. Oh, this is the hardest song. Okay. You know what happened? I actually hit the control stick with my wrist by accident, so it's messed up. Okay, so now comes Woodfall Temple. If you notice, we do these temples out of order, which is really cool. And that's just the optimal way of doing it. The only one we do in order is the fourth, which is Stone Tower Temple. But Woodfall Temple, this has the trick that I'm scared of. This could cost me a few minutes if I miss it. But if once I'm past that, I'm good. I don't mind anything else. I just hope it works. Then I can get through the rest of this run and chill and watch some OOT. So it's gonna go down. Okay, so see, he just says stuff real fast, no one cares again. We go like this. Okay. Let's do this. So this is why we went to the sonata room in the first place. We went and got the song just so we could play that. If we can get into the temple without doing this, we can skip getting the song. But right now it's impossible to do that because there's no way to get into the temple while it's underground. Although the temple's there, you can't get to the entrance because you can't swim in out-of-bounds water in this game. You void out. But in Ocarina of Time, if this were Ocarina of Time, you could do it. Because you could use the Zora to just swim in out-of-bounds water and do it, which would... Like, in Ocarina of Time, you can swim in out-of-bounds water, which is really cool. Okay, so let's cross this. All right, so Woodfall Temple, the hard part is the second half. The first half's really easy. Oh, nice, I got the little tree boost there. Did you see that? That saves time. Hookshot this. Oh yeah, remember, we have the hookshot, so we can speed that up. That's why we do this temple later, because we can use the stuff we picked up to clear the dungeons fast. So we can get to second floor, which is like the objective of this, to pick up the bow. And we can hookshot this torch. And we can jump slash up here. So we're good. Now we just gotta fight the Lizalfos or whatever his name is, or Dinophos, and grab the bow. This guy's all bark, no bite. He looks horribly terrifying, but you'll see. Oh, he bit me, okay. Spoke too soon, I guess. So the reason I hate this boss is because he always fakes me out. Every time I think he's going straight at me, he pulls a 180, and he always goes behind, and then it sucks, because I lose time, because I gotta chase him down. But two crouch stabs kills him, that's why I say he's all bark, no bite, because like he dies so quickly. Alright, so now we got a bow, and now comes the second half of this temple, which is the hardest part. So hopefully... I'm really scared for this. Let's see if I can do it. If I get past this, we're in good shape. So that's storage again. This time I stored Song of Time so I could save in the boss room, which you're not supposed to actually be able to do. That way we can collect the remains and save. And remember, when you save, as soon as you press yes, you collect whatever it is that you have. So I can skip the cutscene of the giant after. All right, here's the hard part. Got it. Nice. Oh my god, yes. We're in there. It looks like we just like voided out, but we're in the boss room. Okay. Smooth sailing from here, baby. Let's party. Yeah, I think so. I'm flying right now. This is a good run. No pressure. I don't know. Like, this is a really good run though. Arrow to the knee. Oh, hate that. No, it's just cooler. It's just cooler. Yeah, you gotta add some flair to it, man. Alright, so I just reset as soon as I picked up the remains. Didn't have to watch that cutscene, but kept the remains. So now I can move on to the next section, which is the snow world. And we get there in a really cool way, so you'll see what happens. Also, that bomb kill is my favorite thing. It's so sick. Okay, so, dude, we got past the two, like, trump cards of this run. That's why I gave my estimate. So now, like, I'm going to finish way ahead of estimate, hopefully. Unless something catastrophic happens, which I couldn't first... Like, if I died in Majora, it would suck, but that happens. Okay, so we do some parkour. We can grab this chest much quicker this time around because we have a Zora mask. We're going to do the same thing. We're just going to go and buy some bombs because bombs are what make this world go around. And we go to the bomb shop. I'm going to explain a little trick that happens here. So normally, to buy 20 bomb chews, you need to have 80 rupees because they're 40 for a set of 10. But in this game, I'm buying them for less. I'll show you why. I just did that. So what just happened there was I bought 20 bomb chews for 69 rupees. And in this game, you can, if you mash A fast enough after the first purchase, you can buy the second set before the rupee count that you have goes below 40. The game still thinks you can afford it. So you can just smash really quick and buy 20 bomb juice for less.
You time it though, right?
I time it because I time everything. But like, it's 3-frame trick at 69 rupees and a 1-frame trick at 67. All right, so I'm gonna go into this fairy fountain over here, and then I'm gonna go into another fairy fountain and come out in the snow world. Remember how I said the grottos were connected? It's the exact same thing with this route. With the fairy fountains. You can go into a fairy fountain, enter an unloaded one, and then leave that one, and you'll be in that respective area. Okay. So instead of going to heal ourselves in that fairy fountain, we're gonna go to this corner, and again, we can parkour our way up stuff. Infinite sword glitch to do some more hovers. Then we land in the unloaded grotto, and this is the snow world. You can see that the fairies would be this color in this temple. So you know exactly which one you're in. So now I'm here. Then infinite sword glitch. Remember, you can't fall off the edge if you have your sword slashing. The wind doesn't blow me off the cliff. So I can work my way around Snowhead into the temple using this exploit. Got some arrows. That kicks so much because I can use the arrows for a trick called Action Swap, which makes a flaming arrow out of thin air. You'll see. That's bad luck. Okay, so that's a luck-based trick. The wind has to be a good timing so that it blows you to the back. The super slide has to reach the back end. Also, for some reason, the audio is being weird and I can't hear the wind spawn. No, it's weird. Okay. Okay, that's gonna work. That's good. Second try is perfect. I'm totally cool with that. So it goes around the back. You go in the corner. And we work our way around. That was really good. The second blow-in was awesome. Alright, I'm gonna chill here. Because that snowball always makes me nervous. Alright, we're good. Also, that snowball I blew up at the bottom actually gives me... not only does it drop arrows potentially, which are useful, but it also lets me avoid the snowball from spawning up here, because it normally starts up here. So I can clear this part of the area without having to worry about it spawning. And then we climb up here. Oh, that was scary. I almost just fell off. It's because I can't hear the audio. Okay. Okay, we're in. Everybody calm down. Okay. So here comes the flaming arrow out of thin air. Let's see if I can hit this trick. Oh, I missed it. Okay, I missed it by like a frame. It's a frame perfect trick. It's a 15 second time save done optimally. So it's not the end of the world. I'm just sad I couldn't show it to you guys because it's really like flashy looking. Like what happens is you just see him like make a stick and weird thing and you make a flaming arrow. All right, we can do a cool jump like that. And we just basically have to go around. It's not the end of the world. So I'm gonna equip my Deku stick. That's why I paused. That's like probably, this section's probably been the worst part of the run so far just because I got bad luck in that first area and then I missed action swap, but that's not a big deal. Okay, so here's a weird shot. This lets me hookshot out of bounds. It dislocates first-person camera from Link. Let me try it again. There we go. So now the camera's dislocated from Link's position. I can shoot out of bounds and reach areas I'm not supposed to. So I go up here. Then we can do bomb boosts. Bomb boosting's pretty cool. We basically use the speed of a bomb explosion to carry us on jumping, because that's our distance on a jump is based off our speed value. So I can cross these areas like this. Oh, don't jump off. That's not cool. Oh my god, this is annoying. All right, good. So then we go in here. Now we're going to fight Wizrobe. Shout out to Wizrobe. He's my man. Dude, Wizrobe won the Smash 64 tournament here at STR. He's a beast. Alright, so infinite sword glitch on this guy, I can just stand here and he dies. I use my sword and it looks cool. Yeah, I get wrecked. Then I can hookshot this and it looks like I open the door with a chain. That's kind of cool.
Is there any reason you damage ISG instead of normal ISG?
No, I missed. I missed ISG there. I had to get damage back up. Okay, so I'm going to grab another arrow drop. Actually, I don't think I needed it because I did get arrows. I just missed this. Usually when I don't get action swap, I go for extra arrows. Because that usually means I didn't get an arrow drop, but I missed the actual trick, so not bad. All right, so we go up here. We can do some fancy hovering here. Blow up the snowballs. Okay, remember when I dove as a Zora in Woodfall Temple to store the Song of Time? I'm gonna do the same thing here, but the method is different. We can do a weird hookshot clip through this torch and then fall out of bounds and do it. So we can get infinite sword glitch off the ice like this. And then fall. And then we play the song. You fall for a long time because they had to extend the thing so they could fit that giant pillar in like the actual dungeon area. It's really funny. Okay, now we're gonna skip the boss key with a really solid trick. This is like the coolest. Like it's so flashy looking, you'll see. It's really clean looking if done well. Nice, you go around the door. So now we're gonna melt this giant dude. And he has a really solid exploit. We can kill him just by, like, we don't even use a glitch. Like, we literally fight this guy just normally. We stand right here. And then we 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And then 9 more. Get storage activated, and then he dies. Super fast. That's a sweet spot. So you just like stand there, and he does nothing. and we side hop to reset how long he stands there. Because after a while of standing there doing nothing, he charges you. But if you move over and let him shoot lightning, it resets him standing there doing nothing. So then we do the same thing. Rinse and repeat. Reset. 109 goat, dude, nice. That with all that bad luck in the lullaby skip and stuff and the action swap, this is a pretty good run. It's not PB pace, but I said I wanted to beat this game in under an hour 30, and I'm like well on pace to do that. I think I'm on like 128, 127 pace. Yeah, I'm like within 3 minutes. I know, Majora's, it's gonna happen. It's gonna happen. It's gonna happen. All right, so let's finish strong. What do you say? So Stone Tower Temple uses another time stop. We're gonna do a third time stop in this one, and that's to enter the dungeon. So remember that you can move off of things and cutscenes will trigger without them actually happening until you cancel the effect of time stop. So this particular case takes advantage of this. This cutscene of the block coming here, if you step off the switch, the block returns to the other side. But if we do time stop, the block doesn't move. But if I cancel the glitch on the block, it takes me with it. Whoa, that was a weird camera. So then we enter the temple. Usually you need the Elegy of Emptiness to do that, which is a song that requires, like, you step on all three switches and then all the blocks line up and you can enter. Okay, so Stone Tower Temple takes advantage of weird shots, which we saw in Snowhead very briefly. And here's a trick called the sunblock clip. There's a sunblock in this room. If I stand right here, pull out a bomb, and get in the corner, just like this, the block is absolutely meaningless. Then we can swim up here, grab a key. Okay. Now we're gonna start the weird shot process. Shot through the wall. I need to grab a bomb drop. So these guys have a 50% chance, to drop a bomb. Okay, I got it. Good. Let's move on. And then we do a weird shot through this one. Perfect. We're gonna equip some fire arrows. I'm gonna take out Garo Master with them. Alright, so I hate this guy. He sometimes hits me and kills me, and I hate it. So we'll see what happens. Then I have to do a trick with a bomb, and if that kills me, then it's like I lose like 3 minutes. Oh, damn it. Don't do it. Oh my god, okay. Okay, don't do it again. Okay, I got you. Alright, we're good. We're good. Alright, so now I hope the bomb doesn't kill me. Don't do it. Oh my. It happened. I lost like 4 minutes. Now I gotta go back. The run's dead. Okay. Alright, don't panic. I just fooled all of you. Don't worry. I know what I'm doing. That was a death warp. It saves time because I'm able to get to the dungeon entrance early. Oh my god, come on. Okay, I buffer this weird shot because it has to go straight down. That's a frame perfect weird shot. So I used 2 extra bombs there. That kind of sucks. But it's actually kind of cool because now I'm going to show you an alternate way to do the next room. But that was intentional, by the way. I killed myself because I needed to get to the start. I could have played the Song of Soaring to get back to the beginning, but that's lame. To kill yourself is much cooler, and especially if you get to fool people. Because, like, everybody associates dying to just, like, dang, rip everything. It's over. But we put it in there because it's good. So the panic was installed for just a little. All right, so again, we're going to dive and we're going to store the Song of Time. You can do it right here. Got to do it. That was a close one. You have like no time to play the song there. It voids out like so quick. Okay, then you're going to notice there's no audio. That's because the song storage screws up the audio. We shoot this, and now I'm going to show you a really cool trick. This is called the jump slash recoil in the updraft room. And the reason it's called the updraft room is because there is these updrafts here. We jump slash into it. We recoil off the wall. We land here. Okay, and we pull a bomb out. Crossover. Then he dies. So far, so good. Now I have to do another weird shot. This is a frame-perfect weird shot, okay? And if I miss it, it's not a big deal. Instead of going around the bottom, I get to go around the top. But it'd be cool to get it. It's probably the hardest weird shot for me. So let's see if I get it. Yeah, it's all good. That weird shot's tricky. But yeah, it's so annoying because like then you gotta do this. It's not a big deal. It's like 20 seconds. Yeah, what happens is you go through the floor and you can shoot the BMOS in this room. And in this game, you can hookshot BMOS, which is kind of cool. So we just go around. Now we're on the other side. All right, I'm going to grab the bombs, grab the arrows, stock up on all the supplies, and we're going to do the boss key skip and then fight Twin Mold. Now, Twin Mold's cool. Twin Mold, like, there's the red Twin Mold and the blue Twin Mold. I call them Gyarados because they look like them. So there's a boss key skip. Go out of bounds and enter the loading zone. Now, it's cool because we have fire arrows and the Twin Molds are super effective. They're weak against their opposite arrow color. So the red one's weak against ice arrows and the blue one's weak against fire arrows. We don't have ice arrows, so we're going to use light arrows, which is our next best option. They do triple damage with the elemental and 4 damage to each one with light arrow. So we're going to use fire arrows on the blue one because we have those. And we can also sneak a bomb in there like this. You can score a double hit like that, which is awesome. Now, these guys suck. They always get in my way. Hopefully they don't do that this time. Okay, there goes the blue one. You can see it's like super effective. Like he died like really quickly. Missing one in fire arrow is like no problem whatsoever. Totally cool. Now, the light arrows are annoying because they use double the amount of magic as a fire arrow. So I have to be very conservative with my shots and hope I nail them. Also, when you kill one Twin Mold, the second one starts to move faster, so I have to compensate for his movement. Okay, I got 2. I have a 3rd arrow. Where's he going? Okay, that's not bad. I always make sure he doesn't attack me. He's like dead. Not a terrible fight at all. I mean, I can't really... He always screws me, so it's not a big deal to like... Good. Now all that's left, we beat all 4 temples, we got the Oath to Order, now we just gotta get into the moon, which means get back to the Skull Kid and play the Oath to Order. So we're almost done. Huh? I can't hear because these headphones. Okay, cool. Oh. Dude, it's so hard to hear. I'm like trying to hear, but like the headphones are like noise canceling headphones. But I got you, bro. I got it. Yeah. Okay. I wish they had more headphones so we could all just like talk in the, like we could hear each other. Okay. So I gotta get a bomb drop and a Deku stick for the Majora fight. You'll see what happens. So the Deku stick we can grab from a Baba, which is like right here. And then we go in here. And then bomb drops is luck based. Okay, awesome. I got it. First try. That's random. Completely random. This is looking... Dude, I can beat the game in under an hour and a half. If I beat this game in under an hour and a half, I will be so... I will like literally just like pop off. I'll just like whatevs. Sub 130 at a marathon would be so... This, I wanted it, dude. I wanted it so bad. Yeah, I still got Majora, so I'm not gonna toot my own horn yet, bro, you know? Ugh. I hate this angle change. I take my time. Okay, I just wanted to take my time because if you run out of bombs and you do it wrong, you're kind of in trouble. But yeah, there's no hit detection at the top, so we can just hop into the loading zone. That's good.
That's how you bring the dog up there, just to unlock the camera.
We use the Franker Z. Okay, so the only way to turn around, like optimally with bombs, is to untarget the camera during a hover. We do it with bomb chews, but because we don't have any, we need something else we can target. So the Franker Z, you can target it while you're in the air. So it doubles as a bonus because we can get infinite sword glitch off the dog. We can Franker Z ISG is what we call it. Yeah. Let's finish this. And now we have an amazing, riveting 5-minute cutscene. It's gonna take us an eternity. But, dude, okay, so I get to like kinda overlap. This run was pretty solid, man. I honestly had a couple of bad things that happened in this run. There was the bad wind that happened. That was out of my control. I missed Action Swap, which is a real bummer because I wanted to showcase it, but it's all good. Like I do it on my stream all the time. And then I have, I messed up the weird shot a few times. I missed, nothing too crazy. Like the run was pretty smooth. I hit the big stuff, like all those really dangerous run killing things went really well, which I'm like really happy about because I was so nervous that like I'd have to like go back and like try it again and like waste 4 minutes, whatever. But I really hope everybody watching enjoyed it. It's like, it's not over yet. We still gotta fight Majora. So stay tuned for that. Majora is hilariously ridiculous as a boss. Like, it is a 10 out of 10, and like I mean that in the utmost sarcasm. Worst, like the best boss ever designed. Like the first phase, you can knock it out of bounds, so it's unkillable, which is like ridiculous. The hitbox like detaches from its actual body, so you can't even hit it sometimes. The second phase is like Michael Jackson. It just dances around moonwalking. I swear, it's literally Michael Jackson. And the third phase is just literally an onslaught of orbs of death that land in your face for like 20 seconds when you try to kill it. So you'll see, it's like the worst thing. It can go really well or really bad. There's no like medium. It's just like one or the other. But yeah, I really hope you enjoyed it. I hope you saw what I meant by like the beginning is just like super boring. And then it's like nonstop action after. There's like maybe one or two like longer cutscenes in the middle of the actual gameplay. So this was an any percent speedrun. If you're not familiar with terminology for speedrunning, any percent means beat the game from start to finish without any restrictions. So you're free to do whatever you want. So technically anything classifies as an any percent, but typically what it means is beat the game as fast as possible. That's just like what we use. And there's other categories in this game actually. There's all masks, which is beat the game and collect all the different masks in the game. So if you get all the masks, basically get the Fierce Deity mask at the end and complete Majora fight. There is 100%, which is completing the game and getting everything, which is all the dungeon maps, all the boss keys, all the dungeon maps, all the compasses, all the owl statues, all the heart pieces, all the masks, everything. And it's a long run. All Masks is about 2 hours, and it's about 3 hours if done average. And 100% is done in about 5 hours, 20, 25 minutes if done well, decently. The world record for All Masks is 2 hours, 38 minutes. And the world record for 100% is 5 hours and 10 minutes. And All Masks is by VPP, and 100% is by Trev Person. Right now, on my channel, I'm running 100%. And I just took time. I couldn't do 100% here because it's like way too long. But when I get back home, I'm definitely going to be working on 100%. I've already been doing it for a few weeks. And there's a lot of runners actually doing 100% now in preparation for AGDQ 2016. So you should definitely check out the Majora's Mask runners. Check out Full Grown Gaming, Trev Person. Check out Faneer, who's the world record holder for any percent. Check out VPP. He's just all mask runs lately. Thiefbug, he's like an amazing Majora's Mask speedrunner. They're like the main five. And definitely give him support. Follow Majora's Mask as a channel, and you can definitely, almost all the time, there's someone streaming Majora's Mask. And, like, I apologize if I didn't name you, but, like, there's a lot, like, the top 15 people are amazing at MM. Like, they're all so good, and I recommend checking all of them out, honestly. So, yeah, I'll be doing 100% runs. It's long, but it's cool, very different. And I really hope you guys enjoyed it. I always like this cutscene because I get the time to like talk about like the community and stuff. Like lately there's been a ton of improvements to the routes and stuff. Everybody's always like working on routing and like trying to optimize little things here and there. Definitely check out Enop. If you haven't watched Enop, you live under a rock. He was the guy that inspired me to start running Majora's Mask. But yeah. All right, so that's good. That little speech basically carried us through this cutscene. We're gonna go fight the Majora fight, and then get ready on the time. Like, hit the timer when I kill Majora. Just say time. Okay, cool. I'll make us all deaf. Cool, sounds good. All right, so one final super slide of success. Okay, we're in business. Equip light arrows and Deku stick. Now, I like to stop right in front of this guy and get, like, a perfect talk. Oh, I just missed it. It was a little early. Okay. Oops. Okay. All right, so here comes the Majora fight. Dude, I'm gonna get a fucking sub 130. Excuse my French. Like, I'm getting a sub 130 in this run right now.
Let's go.
I don't care.
Do it.
This is happening. I have 3 minutes to kill this guy. I can get, oh my god, I can get a 128 with this run. Let's go. It's happening. This is happening, dude. All right, this guy's going down. Let's hope he doesn't have any shenanigans for me. We're beating the game in under an hour and a half right now. Get home. Let's party. Let's do this. Okay, so far so good. Okay. Taking it slow so he doesn't screw me around, because he can go out of bounds and then it's over. Okay. Teabag. Nice. Okay, that's one. Two more phases. Dude, he's gonna Michael Jackson, I swear. If he Michael Jackson's, I gotta chase him down. Hope there's a really good chance he runs into me. If he runs straight at me, I get a quick knockdown. I can kill him like in 10 seconds. Let's see if I get it. Oh, baby. Let's party. Get owned. Let's go. I got him. He's going to do his little whatever. All right, that's two. One more. 128? Can I 128? Can I 128 this? That's like within 2 minutes of my personal best. Oh Oh my god, I got kicked in the face because the Remain took the arrow for me. What a guy. It's okay, I got it. Get down. Time. 128, baby! We're 128! Oh my god, dude. 128 at a marathon run is absurd. Insane plays, dude. Humongous colossal titan plays. 128.
128.52. Nice.
That's my marathon PB. Insane. Dude, that's it. Like, we went off with a bang, what can I say? So, what's gonna happen next? I'm finished here. I'm gonna go celebrate my 128.52 with a slice of pepperoni pizza. And they're gonna play OOT, and I'm gonna come back on the couch, and they're gonna swap, and they're gonna play OOT. We're all gonna swap, and I'm just gonna be like chilling this time. So, I really hope you enjoyed this run. Again, follow the Majora's Mask guys. I appreciate you guys watching. If you have any feedback and you like the run, dude, please come to my chat and like let me know. I stream 5 days a week. I really hope you guys like enjoyed it and everything. And yeah, it's been a pleasure, guys.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Do you think at all that getting used to the 480p TV might have helped?
No, that didn't help at all.
It didn't help at all? You just had a great run?
No, it was like...
You just on it?
Yeah, there was also good luck. There was like a lot of good stuff that went my way. I nailed the hard tricks, which is like skill-based.
All right, that's awesome.
Yeah, dude, that was huge.
I'll be honest, I've never watched this run before, but I was hyped the whole time.
Okay,
I love glitches.
That's what I like.
That's crazy.
That's what I said where, at the beginning. Even if you've never seen this, it's like insane to watch because it's just like, why? Like, why is this allowed in a game? Like, what? So...
OOT's really
similar. Dude, get ready for OOT. It's even more ridiculous. We're going to warp all over the place. It's going to be awesome. All
right.
Enjoy the rest of the marathon, everybody.